Hello once more. This is your third section, which is dynamics, plus or minus 10 marks in your final exam. Again, this video, I will just summarize the basic equations which you use to solve the problems in your dynamics. And of course, you need to understand this theoretical background before you solve the problem on your dynamics. It's one of the most important things because you need to derive equations. You don't have a specific equations to use, it always depends on the problems. So it's very important that you understand the theory before you go and attempt to solve the problems on the dynamics. So I will only summarize with you the most important aspect that you must check before you solve the problems. Now, we start with these important terms. These are terminology which is being used in your dynamics. You need to recall and study 3 Newton's law of motion. All your calculations will be based on your Newton's law of motion. So you need to go to your textbook and understand your 3 Newton's law of motion, research on your 3 Newton's law of motion. You also need to understand your coefficient of friction. We're going to use the coefficient of friction to find your friction force, which most likely to be there in your object. You also need to understand your inertial force. You will have your inertial force as well acting on your object. You need to understand these 2 types of energy, your kinetic and potential energy. We will start, once we're done with our Newton's law, we're going to go to kinetic and potential energy. Your problem is either you solve with your Newton's law or you solve it using your kinetic and potential energy. And then your law of conservation of energy. For the sake of your marks, you need to know what happened if your energy, when you lose your kinetic energy, if it's going up an incline, then you lose your kinetic energy. It's not completely lost, but you gain your potential energy. So we're going to study as well your kinetic and potential energy. Now, you need to go and check all these terms before you attempt to solve your problems, because they will ask you this term. They will ask you Newton's law, coefficient of friction, inertial force, kinetic and potential, and then your law of conservation of energy. Now, your problem will either have an object going in a straight line, as you could see, I've drawn it for you there. This is an object going in a straight line, and then your object might as well be in an inclined, as you could see that one. So you might have 2 types of your problems there. So your questions might be two-folded. All right, now, let's analyze this object in a second. If you could check, this is my vehicle with a certain mass in terms, so it's moving in a straight line. And then this arrow show you the direction. So it was going toward east. So this is a motion, it's going to the direction, it's accelerating towards east. What is happening on the object? You have this force applied on the object, which move it towards the direction. Since it's accelerating, that means you have an applied force, which will move it from this position to a certain position. And then this, the mass of this vehicle as well, is subjected to, this is a motion going, accelerating towards east, and then you also give in a friction force. You most likely to have a friction force. And then you have an inertial force. Whenever an object is accelerating, it will have an inertial force. And then you might also give in your friction force. So you have 3 forces acting on this object. Now, your FA, your textbook might use a different terminology. My FA, it always stands for applied force. FU, it's a friction force. FI, inertia force. This inertia force, before you use your equation, you need to find your acceleration, because your inertia force is always MA. Your friction force, it's your coefficient of friction multiplied by force perpendicular to a plane, if you need to, which is MT, if you are giving your coefficient of friction, or most likely they will give you your friction force. Now, this is your equation that is being derived. This is not a standard equation. It always depends on the direction of your object. This is my equation. Force going toward east is equal to a force going toward west. this is the equation that you derive. It's not just that the equation is not the only formula shift because it depends on the conditions of the object. This object was accelerating with this applied force subjected to a friction force and your inertia force. Force going to this direction is equal to a force going to your towards east. Now we have this, your second object, it's an example where your object is decelerating. In other words, the brake is applied now to your object. It has to stop at a certain distance. You can notice now, if you apply the brake, that means the motion is still going towards east, but now the brake is applied. Your friction force always opposes the motion. So you just check the direction, your motion, and then your friction force will always oppose the motion. Now it's a braking force. It has to put this object into rest. So it will oppose the motion as well because it's now a braking force. Inertia force always opposes the force that is applied to an object. Now since the applied force is your braking force, which will bring this object into rest, your inertia force will now change. Your inertia force always opposes this. You could see the applied force was going towards east, your inertia force going towards west. Now you have to put this object into rest. You're breaking this object. It was going towards east. This is the motion of the object. Friction force always opposes the motion. Breaking force, that means since the initial force always opposes the force applied, to this object, now is your breaking force. Your initial force is going to the opposite direction. So these are two forces. Now this is a new equation that you have derived. Okay, this is the object in a straight line. If it's accelerating and decelerating, this is how you need to play around with your equations, not the standard equations. Now, let's look at an object in an inclined. This is the object in an inclined. This is your vehicle again going up an inclined with a certain mass. Now, we have this force applied on the object, accelerating upward. It will cover the distance of an inclined. Since the motion is toward this direction, your friction force always opposes the motion. Here is your friction force. It opposes the motion. And then your applied force is going toward east. This is your inertia force. Always opposes your applied force. And then you will have this force. This force is always there. Your force parallel to the plane. This is your new force. The first three was there on a straight line, and then you have this force parallel to a plane. It will always be there if your force is going up in incline. You have this force parallel to a plane. Now, what is the new equation? Force going upward is equal to a force going downward. You have FA is equal to applied force is equal to inertia force, friction force, plus force parallel to the plane. This force parallel to the plane. This force parallel to the plane is equal to weight sine theta. It is your force parallel to the plane. It's always W sine theta, meaning it's mg sine theta. So this is how you derive your equation when you are on an incline. Let's assume this object was going apart and now you apply to your brakes. This is how you will have your object now. This is your inclined of a certain height, theta. This was the object. Now, it's decelerating. Now, if it's decelerating, it means the motion is still going upward. The first force that should always be there if it's an inclined is that force parallel to the plane, FP. You show that the force parallel to the plane is there. Mg sine theta, that is your FP. Now, the object was going upward, data motion, but you're applying your braking force. It is FB. You want to put this object into rest. And then also, your friction force. Since the motion is going upward, your friction force always opposes the motion. in this side you have your inertia force. Your inertia force always opposes the force applied to the plane. Look at your new equation now. You have Fu plus Fb plus Fp is equal to Fi. Then you make your unknown the subject of the formula. This is how you make your equations. So this is a new equation now. Your equation will always depend on the motion and your applied force. What you need to note, your Fu, friction force, always opposes the motion. And then your inertia force always opposes applied force. And then the last one, force parallel to a plane. It's always downward. That is how you derive the equation. You just check your motion, your friction force will oppose the motion, your inertia force will always oppose your applied force, and then force parallel to the plane, it always goes downward. Those are your main forces that will help you to derive this equation that you need to use to solve your problems. Let's look now how you incorporate your kinetic and potential. Alright, let us look at how we're gonna incorporate a potential and a kinetic energy. We just have to now derive the last equation, and then from there we're going to put in how your potential and kinetic energy works. So you have this object now, it's on an inclined, accelerating downward. You draw your object going downward. This is my object. So the motion is downward. You have this force Fp which is always there. Force parallel to the plane, which is mg sine theta. This object, your force is being applied going downward. Fa is for an applied force. Since the motion is going downward, that means your friction force is in this direction. Again, your applied force is downward. Your inertia force always opposes your force applied. So you have inertia force. Your equation will look like this now. Force applied plus force parallel to the plane is equal to friction force plus inertia force. You could see that your equation varies depending on the conditions of your object. Now, you have this vertical distance, h. If your object is in this position, subjected to your potential energy, from your surface with this vertical distance, so you can calculate your potential energy when it's at the top there. Your EP, standing for your potential energy, it's mgh. That is your energy against gravity. It is your energy that your object possesses against the surface. So it's mgh, always your vertical distance from the surface. Therefore, how are you going to get this h? That is how you get your h, or opposite over hypotenuse. This s, it's a distance of an inclined. This is S, your distance of an inclined from this position to the. So it depending where you calculate your potential energy. If they want your potential energy at this point, then you can calculate an H from this point. But your H will be this distance to that to that position. You're just trying to convert your inclined to your vertical. You're using your sign. It's S sine theta. You're getting your vertical distance. Since it's opposite over hypotenuse. So sine theta is opposite of a hypotenuse, making your HS antigen formula. So if it's up there in an inclined, it possesses your potential energy. And then since it's moving from that position going downward, as it moves, it now possesses kinetic energy, which is half mv squared. That is the energy the object possesses while it is in motion. So it is subjected to your kinetic energy. Now, this is potential, this is kinetic. What you need to know again is that if it loses potential energy as it's moving from the top going downward, it's gaining your kinetic energy. Meaning potential energy at the top is equal to kinetic energy at the bottom. So the loss in potential energy is your gain in kinetic. If it's moving from up the incline going downward, if it is in this position down the surface now, that means the whole of your potential energy has been converted to kinetic energy. So this is your law of conservation of energy. You have your potential energy, the energy that it possesses against gravity. You have your kinetic, your energy in motion, and then your law of conservation of energy, meaning you will not lose your energy, but it will be converted from one source to another. If it's moving down the incline going upward, as it moves from the surface, it loses the kinetic, gaining the potential. Once it goes to rest in this position, this means the whole kinetic energy possesses while it was moving has been converted to your potential energy. Now, if you use this equation, you should be careful. If you are given your friction force, you should also, you should subtract this energy should be gained by, say you had a kinetic energy, you want to get your potential energy, you subtract your energy that will be taken by your friction force. That energy should be taken by your friction force will be force applied, I mean friction force multiplied by distance. So this is your work done by your friction force. So the distance of this incline, you need to subtract it if you're using your potential energy. If you are not giving a friction force, that means it's a frictionless surface. All your converted energy will go to another. So that means all your converted potential energy will be taken by your kinetic energy. So your potential energy is equal to kinetic energy minus the energy. So they're sharing this energy. If you want to get your potential energy as it moves upward, if it was moving up, your potential energy, one will be gained by kinetic and then the other will be gained by your friction energy, your energy by friction. So they're sharing the energy there. So this is the last part under your equations. Now, also, what you need to know are your linear equations. They are still applicable. We're still going to use our linear equation. If this object is moving from one point to another, that means it's moving with a certain velocity. It might have an initial if it's moving from rest going to a certain stage, or if it's going toward rest. So it has a first, initial and final velocity. It has acceleration. It has time. It covers a certain distance, meaning we can use the linear equation as well to calculate. So your three linear equations are still applicable. These three linear equations are still applicable. You might still be required to calculate power. Which is work done over time taken. You might still be calculating power, or power might be force applied multiplied by velocity. This is an average force divided by two. This is inwards, and efficiency is output over input times 100%. These are your equations. These are additional equations. Remember, you have those equations, these ones, which will always depend on the conditions. And then you have a potential and kinetic energy if it is on an inclined. it might have a potential energy. But if it's on a straight surface, it only possesses kinetic, because this one is an energy against the surface. The law of conservation of energy, energy at the top is equal to energy at the bottom. You use this equation to calculate your initial final velocity, acceleration, and the time it took. You can calculate power and then your efficiency if they want your power input. That is the all the knowledge that you need to calculate your the problems on your in dynamics. Now, I will just do your examples now. My next list, I will be doing my examples on your on these problems.